And so we're going to begin this session with Zoro doing another drum solo, and then he's going to come and continue in the messages that he's been speaking. So,
how are we doing today? Come on, Morningstar. This is the last day of 2022. Are we glad it's almost over? We can begin a new year, 2023, and I'm excited. First, I just have to tell you that I'm super, I travel all over the world, as you guys know, as a musician, as a speaker, as a teacher. And most of the time, wherever I go, I'm always pouring myself out. And by the time I leave, I'm completely depleted, because how many know that peopling is a lot of work, right? Just pouring yourself out to people, speaking, teaching, playing, praying, all that stuff. It's exhausting, but it's great. It's the work of the Lord. This is the one place I come to, and whenever Rick invites me, I get super excited, because I know that I'm not going to leave depleted. I'm going to leave full because of the giftings of the people around here. Yeah, give it up. I never leave empty, even though I give everything I have. I leave full because of Rick, people on the team, the music, the messages, all the people speaking. I just get pumped up. And I've received prophetic words here in the many years that I've been coming here that have shaped and changed my life and have changed my destiny. And I've been given prayers by people that just, I don't know, it's like you've run out of serum and then somebody injects you and it's enough to get you through the next year, two or three or whatever, right? So that's how I feel. And plus I have a lot of friends that I've made here over the years, and friends like Rick Eldridge and his wife, Krista, and just Nicholas and Bob Weiner, and just Tom and just his wife, Marianne, just people that I love coming to see. So I just had to get that out of the way first. It has nothing to do with my message, except I'm very happy. And so if I'm happy, I'm going to speak better. So all of the messages that I've been sharing with you, as you can tell, my gift to the body of Christ is that I'm an encourager, I'm a teacher, I'm a rallier. That's what God gave me. I'm a very simple man, but sometimes everything that Jesus taught was very simple to understand, but very difficult to actually do. So some of the things in life that we know we ought to do, we're not doing. So simple doesn't mean that it's easy to execute. But one of the things, we're talking about prophetic vision and our vision for the future and all those things, which is awesome and incredible. And all these prophetic words are incredible. But then I try to bring things down to like the personal, because we're in this journey on a personal level as part of a bigger picture. We're actors in a big screenplay when there's a lot of different action going on. But you've been given a part by God, and then how do you play your role? I'm not responsible for being Chris Reed, because I'm not Chris Reed. I'm not responsible for being Rick Joyner. All we can be is us. We're responsible for being us and playing the part and the role we're supposed to play. But one of the things that I've learned to cling on to since I was young was words. And I've always loved words. Some of you know my story, some of you don't, but I'm not going to go into the whole thing. But I grew up without a father. I grew up with a single immigrant mother who raised 7 children alone. Our life was extremely difficult, and I found out early on that the thing that got me through life was words. The power, I understood the power of words, words from the Bible, words that my mother spoke, motivational quotes. Where I wasn't hearing it in real life, I was gonna find it for myself. I was gonna find those words and speak those words. So my message today is called The Power of Words. So I wanna read something to you. You've probably heard this verse, John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word. I like it already. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So he is the Word. Genesis verses 1 through 11. The first one says this. We've all heard it, but one day it kind of really clicked with me. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. Verse 1:6 says, and God said, let there be a vault between the waters to separate water from water. Verse 9, and God said, let the water under the sky be gathered to one place, and let dry ground appear. And it was so. Verse 11, then God said, let the land produce vegetation, seed-bearing plants, and trees on the land that bear fruit with seed in it, according to their various kinds. And it was so. What was fascinating to me in reading that is that the scriptures confirm that God simply spoke light into existence when he said, let there be light. Notice it didn't say he started working on light for 11 trillion years. Everything God created, he spoke into existence through the power of words. He spoke it and it became. So words, and the Bible says that we are made in his image, and one of, it means many different things, but one of those things is we can also speak. Like he gave us the power of speech. That's what makes human beings what we are. We're different than animals. We have the power of speech. We have the power of words. So he made us into his image. So he's given us the same power to create worlds within our own lives by the things that we say. Good or bad, the truth is just about everything we do begins with the declaration of words. Everything we do begins with the declaration of words. When somebody dreams of going to the Olympics, they'll say, I'm going to win a gold medal. Or if somebody wants to get even with somebody, they'll go, I'm getting even with that person. Almost everything you do first, you say it. You say it in your head, you say it in your mind, you say it verbally. Everything we do begins with what we say. Stuart Chase put it this way. He said, words are what holds society together. Without them, we should not be human beings. And then Rudyard Kipling, the author most known for his book, The Jungle Book, he was an English author and poet, he said this, words are, of course, the most powerful drug used by mankind. That's a heavy, heavy statement. Words are, of course, the most powerful drug used by mankind. Now, General Boykin could attest to this. Every war was started and ended with the proclamation of words. When we declared war, we said, we are declaring war on Japan. Every war begins with words, and every war ends with words. Some people get together and say, this is what we're going to do. We're going to end this, and this is what we're going to do. We're going to start this. So every war begins and ends with words. It's so crazy if you think about it. And words have power. Words have incredible power. But we must learn to control that power by learning to control our tongue. We don't have a lot of control over things that happen to us or things that people do to us. We don't have that control, but we have control over what comes out of our mouth and what we speak and what we say. So words help to shape the future. What is the prophetic if not words that shape the future? That is what the prophetic is. The prophetic is words that are determining and changing individual futures, and God telling you the future through his prophets, through words. He's not telling you subliminally. He's telling you through somebody speaking something. So the words have incredible power, but we have the ability to shape our destiny and greatly impact the lives of others by the words that we speak. So you have way more power than you think. Listen to what this famous man's mother said about him. I'll reveal who he is at the end, but this is what this man's mother said to him. Said, my mother said, when I was a child, my mother said to me, if you become a soldier, you'll be a general. If you become a monk, you'll end up as the Pope. Instead, I became a painter and wound up as Picasso. This was Pablo Picasso's mother who spoke that to him. She lifted him up. She gave him a vision for his life. She said, whatever you do, you're going to be the greatest. He said, I became a painter, and I wound up as Picasso. Listen to what this famous woman's mother told her. She said, my doctor told me I would never walk again. My mother told me I would. I believed my mother. This was Wilma Rudolph, Olympic champion in track and field in 1956 and 1960. You could clap for her. I'm sure she'd be happy. You're not clapping for me, you're clapping for an Olympic Victorian. But her mother said, you will walk again. So who are we going to choose to believe? Now, I want to share with you a few personal stories of my own life. My life, the reason I'm up here today is because of words that were spoken over me, words that shaped my life. My life has been shaped by words more than anything. The words prophesied over me, the words prayed over me, the words people spoke over me, the encouraging words people gave me. My whole life has been shaped by words. You know that old saying, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. That's the biggest lie in the world. You'll spend your whole life getting over a bad sentence that somebody said to you in junior high, and your bones will heal really quickly, but words penetrate. In fact, I think there's been some studies done that everything in this universe is sound. So when God spoke the universe into existence, it's sound that created everything. And there's studies that say that all the walls everywhere have memories, and the sounds are in the walls, like the conversations people, that saying, if the walls could talk, you know, if these walls could talk, they can. Everything is recorded in the universe. Everything is a sound. Everything is a vibration. So these things are very important. So words shape my life. So I told you earlier, I didn't start playing drums until I was 16. So that's very late to start playing the drums, you know, because most of the guys I knew started when they were 2 or 3 years old. So it's very late. And by the time I was 17, I'd already had a particular band that I really liked. I loved all kinds of music, but I had an affinity at that time for jazz, what you call jazz fusion music, kind of funky soul jazz music. Anyway, there was a group that I loved. They were called the Jeff Lorber Fusion. That was the name of the group. And I remember going to see them in Eugene, Oregon. They were playing in a ballroom at a hotel. And I was always a very bold kid, and so I was determined that I want to meet the band. I'm going to meet those guys. And so I went to the lobby of the hotel where they were staying, in the ballroom where they were playing, and I just waited there for the band so I could meet them. Anyway, I ended up meeting them, and they befriended me, and they let me come to their sound check to see them check the instruments and play, and I thought it was really cool. Like, wow, I'm at the sound check of my favorite band. And I'd only been playing a very short time, but again, I had a lot of audacity as a kid. So I remember when they were done with the sound check, I went up to the drummer and said, can I get a hop on the drums and play so you can see how I play? I want to show you how I play and see what you think. You know, and now I look back, I was totally crazy. But I did it, and then I remember the bass player, his name was Danny Wilson, and he stood by me with his hands kind of like that. When I was done playing, he goes, "Oh, kid." He goes, "You're going to be one of them superstar drummers." And that's just, it was just like one sentence. He said, "Oh, kid, you're going to be one of them superstar drummers." And man, it was like a bolt of lightning hit me, because I had not heard lots of words of affirmation, but it was coming from a bass player from my favorite group at the time, who I respected and admired. Now, to this day, I don't know whether he was lying or just trying to make me feel good. All I know is that at 17, I believed that he believed it. So therefore, I believed it. And when I moved down to Los Angeles after I graduated high school in 1980, and I began to pursue my dreams of being a musician, and I ran into all kinds of opposition and disappointment, as you do in show business, the one thing that kept me going is that one sentence that Danny Wilson said, because I could just hear him say it over and over, "Oh, kid, you're going to be one of them superstar drummers." And I was like, well, if Danny Wilson could feel that way about me, I can't quit, because he thinks that I could be that. So I must be able to be that. So one sentence literally changed my life. And that was at 17. So then a few years later, I was 21, and I get my big break, and I'm playing with a group called the New Edition, and they were the biggest thing in the 80s. They were like the Jackson 5 of the 80s. They're still popular. But anyway, that was my first big gig. So a year after that, I'm in the fan magazines. I'm becoming like a famous drummer. And all of a sudden, I realize there's younger drummers that are now looking up to me and that like me. So there was this one kid. He came backstage to one of the New Edition concerts. He's about 12 years old. And his dad brought him back there to meet me, and he wanted to ask me questions about the drums and cymbals. And of course, I just loved on him and encouraged him. And I said, "Oh man, can I take a picture with you? Oh, why do you want a picture with me? So when you're famous, I can say I had a picture with you, like when you were 12 years old." So I wanted to pump him up. I wanted to make him feel good, because I said, "You're going to be a superstar drummer one day." You know, several years later, he became a superstar drummer. His name was John Blackwell, and he became the drummer for Prince. And then he was on the cover of Modern Drummer magazine like I was, and then he wore a hat. And in his article, he said, "I wear a hat because my hero Zoro wears a hat." And he remembered me, and he goes, I learned so much from Zoro. And what, so I had this beautiful chance to like pay it forward, because I remembered what that sentence felt like to me. And I've said that to 1,000 drummers around the world. And it doesn't matter if they all become a world famous drummer or not. Sometimes drumming or whatever your hobby is just a thing to keep you out of trouble for a while. Sometimes it's something just to keep you motivated until you find the real dream. But I had always been mindful of speaking words of life to people wherever I went, because I remembered how much that single sentence just changed my life. And I've never been able to get in touch with Danny Wilson since then. I lost track of him. But I always wanted to tell him, I tell your story all the time, just so he would know. The Bible says in Proverbs 18:21, death and life are in the power of the tongue. Death and life. I can say with certainty that the words I have decreed over myself and my family have altered the course of my life, my marriage, and the lives of my children. Words have brought me to my present day reality. Listen to what Claude M. Bristol said, an American soldier and author. He said, it's the repetition of affirmations that leads to belief. And once that belief becomes a deep conviction, things begin to happen. It's the repetition of affirmations. That's what God's asking us to do. Listen to these self-fulfilled prophecies. One of my favorite artists, my mother took me to see him in concert when I was 12 years old, and it was never the same after I saw Frank Sinatra. It was absolutely incredible and mesmerizing. She raised me on his music, so I already knew all of his songs and his catalog. But then when I saw the chairman of the board, old Blue Eyes, doing it live, I was like, I want to be on stage like him. I didn't even know I wanted to be a drummer then, but I wanted to be part of show business. But this is what Frank said. When Frank Sinatra was a young man, before he had made a name for himself, he was nobody. He attended a Bing Crosby concert with his first wife, Nancy. And he turned to her and said, you know what? I'm going to be a professional singer. Someday I'm going to be up there. Like I told you earlier, I'm going places. He later told his father, well, you know, Dad, I've given it a lot of thought. I really want to pursue the singing thing. I believe I can be as good as or better than Bing Crosby. That's like an athlete saying you're going to be better than LeBron James. You know what I mean? Because Bing Crosby was it during that time. But that's the power of words. Listen, it only takes a minute or even seconds to change a life. It doesn't take people, again, I said yesterday or the day before, you know, people sometimes think they have to go on some mission trip to the farthest place in the world or go to Siberia to convert somebody, to bring them to the Lord. You don't have to go anywhere. You just have to walk around. Your words can change the destiny of people all around you by speaking positive words. It literally only takes a second. Some people are one sentence away from suicide. They're one bad report, one bad comment, one nasty comment on the plane or at McDonald's or just getting mad at people. Some people are a sentence away from checking out. All they need is one more person to lump on something negative or speak to them in a bad way or just be mean or rude to them. They're 1 second away from killing themselves, one sentence away from killing themselves. Some people are one sentence away from changing the world in a radically great way, one sentence away from curing cancer. All they need is somebody to come along and say something positive about them that all of a sudden fuels them in a direction that changes everything. I don't know where I'd be if it weren't for that one sentence that Danny Wilson said to me, because I might have quit when I failed all the auditions or people said I wasn't good enough or strong enough or whatever the reason I didn't get the gig. I might have quit, but I kept reciting and replaying that one sentence in my head over and over. Our lives are often changed by single sentences, either spoken to ourselves when we say things like, I'm going to make the honor roll, or when your teacher speaks over you and says, you're never going to amount to much, right? Then we hold on to those words, and then we make those words our identity. Cesar Pavese said this. He said, we do not remember days. We remember moments. It's true. We don't remember days. We remember moments when somebody said something to us. We remember, I was in school one day when my teacher said, you're a loser, or you're a loudmouth. You're never going to amount to anything. We remember all those moments. So we need to use our words to encourage, to heal, to inspire, to forgive, to affirm. We need to use our words to speak to other people's potential. Remember, God always speaks to our potential. He never speaks to who you currently are. He speaks to who he made you to be, who he knows you're capable of being. He's always spoken to human potential. Remember the story in Judges 6:12, an angel appeared to Gideon when he doubted his ability to take on the army. And he said, "The Lord is with you, you mighty man of valor." He said that to him when he was feeling like a coward, like he didn't have enough bravery to go and do anything. He didn't think he could do it. But the angel said, "You mighty man of valor." I want to encourage you that everywhere you go, you have this incredible intrinsic ability that God gave you to literally change the atmosphere of a person's life by speaking like that. The angel didn't say, "Listen, you loser, coward," you know, because that's what he was at the moment. He didn't speak to what he saw. He spoke to what was inside of him if you call it out. And that's how we should speak. Look, listen, Jesus always spoke to people's potential, right? To Peter. Peter denied him three times. He said, "Upon you I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail." This is to a guy who was a traitor, who was a coward, who denied even knowing him. But he didn't say, "Listen, you loser, you're going to deny me three times, and you're going to wound up in hell." You know, he didn't say that. That's what we would say when somebody burns us or denies us or whatever. He spoke to the potential. When Jesus performed his miracles, he spoke them into existence. He said, "Arise and walk," he said to the crippled man. He didn't say, "I got this great doctor in South Carolina. If you go visit him and go through therapy for 12 years, you might be able to get out of the chair." He just said it, "Arise and walk." To a dead man, Lazarus, he just said, "Come forth." He didn't say, "You're dead. This probably won't be able to happen." He always spoke to what he saw could be, what... We're all capable of so much more than what we put out, than we even know we're capable of. We're capable. This is why I wrote my book, Soar. This is why I do what I do, because I'm always trying to speak to people's potential and help them understand with inside you is the kingdom of God. So the kingdom of God is the greatest thing in the universe, but the kingdom lives within us. The kingdom is how we speak, how we walk, how we act, how we behave, how we believe, how we stand in faith. That kingdom is powerful, but part of that, the key to that whole kingdom is your mouth. It's the gateway. Everything you say reflects what you believe, and what comes from inside comes outside. Your words are the way in which God uses you to change the atmosphere. I have always made positive decrees and affirmations over my family. My son couldn't tell you because he was a fetus at the time, but I'll tell you a story. When my wife was pregnant with my firstborn, who's sitting over there, my son Jared, he's 23, this is how much I believed in the power of affirmations and words. So this is before you could record things digitally. I had an old cassette, like a Walkman cassette. Back in the land that I came from, they had called cassette tapes. In the land of my forefathers, they were called 8-tracks. In the land of my great forefathers, it was reel-to-reel tapes. You know, and we can thank a man who changed the universe more than anybody. It was Thomas Edison. He is the one who invented the first device that could record human conversation. Just for you, a tip for you to know, the very first song recorded in the history of existence was "Mary Had a Little Lamb," and it was Thomas Edison singing it into his talking machine that he had been developing. And not long after that became the first recorded music. So just take yourself back to a day like when Mozart played. The only time you could ever hear him is when you were in person. You could never go, "I'm going to put on some Mozart. I'm going to put on some Bach and some Chopin." You know, you can only listen to people, a speaker, when they were live. You couldn't go, "Oh, I'll hear the podcast later." So we have come so far, but Thomas Edison developed that. He also developed the first moving pictures. So all the movies you watch and the film that we watch is because of Thomas Edison. He was a dreamer. But I bring that to you to tell you that I had the device called a Sony Walkman that you could record with. And so I said, "You know what? My wife is pregnant with our child. I want our..." So I made a 90-minute cassette tape of me speaking into the recorder, and it was me saying things like, "This is your father. I can't wait to meet you. You're going to be a world changer. You are already loved. God's got a plan for your life. I was speaking and making decrees. I recited Bible verses. There was poems I wrote for my son. It was 90 minutes of me talking. And then the other part of the tape, I said, let me record some music too, because I want my child to have an appreciation for music. So I recorded James Brown. I recorded Earth, Wind, and Fire. I recorded classical music. I recorded Frank Sinatra, just worship music, just great music. And I read all these studies that said that the fetus can already tell whether it's wanted or not. The fetus can hear you. It's being formed inside its mother's womb, but it's already able to receive. And I read all these things about the brain. The brain can be developed even before you get out of the womb. And so now I have a 23-year-old son who is loving, who is kind, who is smart, but he has loved the Lord since he was 2 or 3 years old. And I got what I prayed for and what I decreed over him and his sister. But I thought, why wait till my child's out in the world? Why shouldn't he know it before he even comes into the world, that he's welcome, that he's wanted? And I made these decrees and declarations over him. And I told my wife, I said, just humor me. You know, while you watch your TV show, just let me put my headphones on your belly and let me play my tape every day. And so she would just watch something on TV, and I'd put the headphones with the speakers there, and I'd play it day after day after day. Now my son he just finished college and wants to be an attorney, wants to follow in the footsteps of Jay Sekulow, and wants to be a world changer. 5 times in his life, it's been prophesied he would be a statesman. So that's the power of words. And my daughter the same. And so we don't have to wait till they're into the world. And I would always tell my son, I said, Jared, you are a prince among men. And to my daughter, I'd say, Jordan, you're a princess among women. And to my wife, I would always say, you are an incredible wife and you bless me and our children. So I'm always trying to speak positive words to them. Now, when my children were younger and they were going to school, I would always, my wife would make their lunch, and every day I would write a sort of a love note in the lunch, and I would write it on a Post-it. And it'd just be something that would come from my heart. And it'd be something like, Jared, you're going to have an encounter today, and you're going to be a blessing to somebody. Or you're going to be a world changer, or God loves you. Or then I would write quotes from, like in my book, like a quote from Michelangelo, a quote from Thomas Edison. And constantly, so I was doing this until they were at about the age of maybe 12 or 13, when they were starting to get embarrassed with the notes. When it was like, and then my son had to come up to me, Dad, I really love you, but like, they're starting to make fun of me in school all the time because of these notes. Can you stop doing that? I said, never be embarrassed that you are loved. Never be embarrassed. You know how, and I would just defensively, I would say, do you know how many dads don't love their kids? Be glad you have a dad that loves you, but I'll stop the notes. But anyway, I kept cramming those notes in and slipping them in between the sandwich and between the chips. It was like a fortune cookie from Dad, you know? And then I taught them to memorize Bible verses from about the age of 3 or 4. My son could memorize 20 verses in the book of Exodus when he was about 4 or 5. Because kids don't know what they can't do until you tell them what they can't do. And so I didn't say, hey, you know, kids can't normally do this. He memorized every single president when you were about, what, 3 or 4. I had flashcards of every single president in history, and I would quiz them on the flash. So I was just like, you know what? Your children are capable of so much. They're capable of so much more than you give them credit for. We are capable of so much more than we're known for. We have to push ourselves. So anyway, I wanted to love on them the way I wished someone had loved on me. So I was making up for what I didn't have as a father. I decided, hey, the curse stops with me. I'm going to be the patriarch to a new generation, and my sons and daughters will only know the love of a father, and they'll only be able to pass that on for generation to generation to generation. We have all been cursed in some way by family in our history, but the buck can stop with us. We can go, this is where it ends. I'm not carrying this on into another generation. So the question is, you know, you've got to take inventory of the kind of words you're using in your life. Are they positive or are they negative? You know, like the classic Fred Astaire song says, accentuate the positive. And Socrates said, the unexamined life is not worth living. So sometimes we need to take inventory. We need to examine, what is my behavior like? Would people say I'm an asset or a liability? Am I a deficit or am I a plus? Are you somebody who drains people or are you somebody who fills people? And we got to be honest and take that inventory and go, if I'm not that person, then I need to pray and ask God to help me become that person who fills people. You don't want to be a drainer. So the question to ask yourself is, what kind of words are you speaking to yourself, to your children, to your spouse, to your family, to your friends, coworkers, the total strangers you encounter every day? Are you speaking words of life wherever you go? Are you being a good steward of your tongue? Are you being a good steward of your tongue? And most importantly, what is the tone of your voice? Because you can say something that on paper looks good, but if the tone of your voice is bad or harsh, then it doesn't come off as good. How many of you have been misunderstood in an argument with your spouse? If you just sent it to them in a letter, it would be different. But because your tone wasn't good, then it came off, they got defensive, right? Your tone determines so much of how people perceive what you have to say. So that's something you have to kind of do some internal research. And you know who best to ask? The people closest to you. Because they'll tell you, you're a jerk. Or you're acting like this, or you're acting like that. Because we often are not aware of our tone and the way we speak. And so sometimes we'll go, oh, I didn't mean it that way. But then your tone came off that way. And then already that person shut down. They're not going to hear what you have to say. So we have to be mindful of our tone. The author Leo Biscaglia said this. He goes, too often we underestimate the power of a touch, a smile, a kind word, a listening ear, an honest compliment, or the smallest act of caring, all of which have the potential to turn a life around. We can turn a life around with all of those simple things. The power of a touch, a smile, a kind word. Jim Carrey, the actor, said, I can live for 2 months on one good compliment. I know when people give me, we all desire and hunger for praise and affirmation. It's one of the most common basic human needs. But when people affirm me, it doesn't make me get more arrogant or more puffed up. What it makes me feel is like, it makes me want to do better. Oh, he really liked that. Oh, that I should rise up and be better so I can affect more people. It affirms me in my calling, and it makes me want to work harder. It makes me want to be a better steward of whatever thing that God gave me that's affecting or impacting this person. So don't be afraid to compliment people, because, you know, encouragement is kind of like, how many of you ate last week? I mean, I know I did. You guys must be on a fast for this whole thing. I guess all of you have been on this New Year's fast. Like, how many of you ate last year? Right? Okay. So, like, I ate yesterday, and that was awesome. It satiated me. It nourished me. But I'm hungry today. Encouragement is like that. Oh, I encouraged my wife last year. Oh, I said something nice to my son when he graduated 20 years ago. I remember that. He seemed to be moved by it. Right? Encouragement is like water and is like food. What I had yesterday is great, but I still need encouragement today, because today is filled with new battles. Today is filled with more discouragement. If we had x-ray goggles and we can see inside of people, we could see their spirit and we could see what they're feeling, we would probably just constantly go up and hug people and say, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. But we can't see inside people. But that's what's going on most of the time, is all kinds of turmoil and hurt and pain and self-doubt and all these things. So like a kind word to a soul walking around is like a drop of water in the Mojave Desert when it's just dry. People are dry. People get knocked down and discouraged in this world every day. So you can never over-encourage somebody. Don't ever fool yourself into thinking, well, they don't need to hear that. They know that already. Or I was nice to them last year. You know what I mean? Like, people need encouragement every day like you need water. And we have the privilege of being able to be a conduit to God's love There's no better way to demonstrate God's love than to be kind to people and speak words of life to them. There's no better way. You might not be able to change their situation. You might not be able to heal them. You might not be able to give them a job or whatever it is they're in great need of. But a kind and encouraging word is the thing you can give them, and it's totally free, and it could totally change their life. And sometimes the people have given me kind words when I've gone through discouraging times. It didn't change the situation, but it made me able to endure for another day, another week, another month, until another person came along and brought me a morsel of goodness. It carries you to the next place. So I'm going to share with you some of the most powerful words ever spoken to me that have changed my life. It began with my mother. Her name was Maria. And when I was a little boy, she used to tell me this story, and she stood by this story till she died. She never recanted the story, but she said, you know, when you were born in the hospital, she said, I saw a bright light around your presence, around your being, around your head, and like a halo. And I used to always just think she was just telling me that to make me feel good, because I didn't have a dad, and I always asked about my dad. Why doesn't he contact me? Why doesn't he love me? And I thought she was just making up a story to make me feel good. But she swore to the day she died, she said, I saw that light. I know what I saw. And then for my first grade school picture, I wanted to be somewhat different, and I wanted to wear a scarf like her, because she always wore these scarves. And there was a rock and roller inside of me from the beginning. Rock and rollers never want to conform. We don't want to dress like other people. It's in our nature as the tribe of creatives. We want to be different. And so my mother always wore these scarves, and she always looked really fancy, even though we didn't have any money. And I always used to say, Mama, you look like a movie star. Like, I want to be like you, and I want to dress like you. So I asked her if I could wear her orange silk scarf for my first grade school picture. And she said, no, mijo, you can't wear my scarf. They'll beat you up. The boys will beat you up in the United States. We don't live in Mexico, you know. But I convinced her, and she let me do it. And then she leaned down on my ear, and she goes, oh, one day, my brave son, you'll do something phantasmical with your life. That was her word, phantasmical, like a combination of fantastic and amazing. But she spoke that over me, and it was a sentence. One day, you'll do something phantasmical with your life, like amazing. And I love the broken English of it, and I always held on to that. And then when I was 12 years old, we had moved from Compton, California, the hood of L.A. We moved to Grants Pass, Oregon, which was like country bumpkin city, a city of 12,000 people, 40 chickens, 2 dogs, a couple of cats, you know. And so it was a complete different life change. But up there, I worked at a music store, and then it was called the Music Shop. And I was a very hard worker, and I worked for this woman. I worked at her store. I used to clean the spokes on her Jaguar and polish her cars. And I had a lot of ambition. And she goes, you know, one day, she goes, you're going to make it big, kid. You're going to make it big, because I've never met anybody who works as hard as you, and you got a good heart. And I promise you, I've met thousands of kids running this music store, but one day you're going to make it big. And her name was Pearl Jones, and I never forgot that sentence. And I told her when I was a little boy, when I was getting interested in music and I was renting my trumpet from her, I said, one day I'm going to be a famous musician. And I'm going to come through town, and I'm going to play, and I'm going to remember you, and I'm going to get you front row tickets to my concert. And I didn't think I was going to feel that way, but anyway, 25 years later, I came through town close to Grants Pass. I was playing with Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons, which was her favorite group, and I said, Pearl, today I'm fulfilling my promise. I got her front row tickets. I told Frankie all about her, and Frankie made a special announcement, and he brought her backstage and said, Pearl, thank you so much for raising my drummer. He's one of the best in the country. Thank you for what you did for him, for giving him his start. It was beautiful. It was like, but I made that promise to her. And I have pictures of that that'll probably be in my memoir at some point. But I brought her and her whole family, and I was like, wow, God, you're so good. But she said that one day you'll make it big. And this is what I mean by when somebody gives me an affirming word. It doesn't make me want to be arrogant. It makes me want to make it happen so that I can show you what you spoke to me came to pass, and you're part of my story, and now it's happened because of what you said. And in fact, she was a non-believer, and the church had rubbed her the wrong way over the years because she had a decent amount of money for that town, and maybe they did something to her. But I was the only person she would ever let pray for her. And every time I came through town, I said, Pearl, and she was pronounced to be dying soon. She had some disease, I forgot, it was cancer or something. I said, would you let me pray for you? And I prayed for her, and I'm not saying it's because I prayed, but I prayed for her, and she lived another 5 or 7 years. And then every time I would get on the phone with her, she would let me pray for her, and I would minister to her all the time. And when she passed, they asked me if I would come and speak at her funeral. And I said, of course I will. I had no idea that they'd appointed me to be the one to be the guy who runs the whole funeral. I forgot the title, you know. I thought I was just going to be one person kind of saying something. But so here's this woman who knew me from when I was 10 years old when I first got to town. How I would never imagine the kids cleaning the spokes of her wheels would be the one kind of leading her to the Lord, sharing the Lord with her, sharing my whole journey with her. Every time I was on the cover of a magazine or on TV, I would call up Pearl, say, hey, I'm going to be on The Tonight Show. Here's my new book. I always honored her. She was always in everything that I did. But it was because she said that sentence to me, one day, kid, you're going to make it big. And it changed my life. And I was sharing that with Alice last night, who's from England, and she had a prophetic word for me. But I was saying, you know, I want your contact information because when these things you prayed over me happen, I want you to know them. I want you to see them come to life. I want you to be a part of it. In all of my books, I have the longest list of acknowledgments that I've ever seen in any book. It'll take you a while to get through the acknowledgments because I want to thank everyone who's been kind to me as a part of the journey. You know, they all, and what's the use of becoming successful or succeeding at something when there's nobody to share it with? And who more important to share it with than the people who all made a little deposit in you? And who could say what was more valuable than the other deposit? It all meant something. And then when I was 16 years old, I had a drum teacher. His name was Kent Clinkingbeard. He was my first professional teacher and mentor. And he started teaching me, but he took me under his wing. And he realized that my brother and I, that we didn't have like an adult male figure in our life. And he came from a family with a little bit of money, and they had a beach house on the coast in Oregon. And one weekend he just said, hey, you know, would you and your brother like to come with me to our beach house? Because my band is playing. So he was in a rock and roll band that was playing at clubs at the time. And he invited me and my brother and paid for everything. And he just said, man, you've got a natural God-given talent. I can't wait to see what's going to happen in your life. He is still my friend to this day. He has followed my career all of this time. We've played together at different things. But when he invited me to that beach house, I'm a new drummer, 16 years old. I want to be around musicians. I get to see them play at the club. I get to hear them talk about music. And he has every time I see him, I said, you have no idea the impact you had on me. He goes, I didn't really do all that much for you. I'm like, you loved on me. You loved on a broken kid who was looking for a male figure to believe in him. You believed in me. You taught me drums. You have no idea how you've impacted me. And we're friends to this very day, Kent and I. And then, as I got into ministry, and I've been in ministry for about 30 years or so, traveling around the world. Ministry has always coexisted with my musical career. When I used to tour with Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons or Lenny Kravitz, I would have a concert with Frankie Valli. I'd have a concert in Vegas at like the MGM Grand or something. It would be like 9 o'clock at night, but I would be known to speak at a church at 7 o'clock at night in town, and then speak at the church and then run as fast as I can in my car to get to the show on time. I would cold call churches. They didn't even know me from a hole in the wall. I said, my name is Zoro. I'm a Christian. I'm in town. Can I speak at your church? Like, I'd literally go in the phone book, look at all the churches around Atlantic City. And, of course, I got turned down most of the time. But every now and then, someone would take a chance on me. And then if they liked me, then I'd get a recommendation letter and say, can you write something so that the next church, they don't think I'm a kook? So I've been in ministry for a long time, and I'd be in Italy with Lenny Kravitz, and on a night off, I'd be speaking at a church. You know, everybody else would be going somewhere else, and I'd be going to a church or during the day speaking at a school or whatever. So ministry, I've been in for a long portion of my life, but how many of you know that ministry can be tough? You know, the toughest part about ministry for me was never ministry, was all the people that rejected me from ministering. Because they didn't like the way I looked, I didn't fit into their mold of what they thought was a conservative, righteous Christian. And I said, there is no such thing as a dress code in heaven. A dress code doesn't qualify your heart for anything. You can never tell what's in a man's heart by his outward appearance. And be wary of that, because you'll judge people wrongly all the time. The person you think looks all proper and conservative will be the pedophile. You know what I mean? And the person that you're afraid of, the biker with the long hair and the beard or whatever, will be the guy who's going to save your kid. We make so many wrong perceptions and judgments based on the way people look. And so I kind of experienced that in ministry my whole life. So it could be very discouraging when I'm just wanting to come there and share and encourage and bring my heart, and then people don't want to let me in. I've had people where I've been at conferences and they didn't know I was the speaker. And I'm standing there and I would have people just look at me with a dirty look because they didn't like the way I was dressed. I'm pretty mellow here, but I can be flamboyant, you know, so I can have scarves and, you know, I'm like a peacock, you know what I mean? I like fashion. But so they would look at me and go, like, and kind of, like just snootily, like just totally write me off. I haven't even opened my mouth. They don't even know who I am, but you could feel their disdain, and that would always hurt me. And I was like, God, why are people like that? Like, it just hurts me so much because they don't know my heart. They don't know who I am, and they've already written me off. And then later, then they'd find out I'm the speaker. And then I had a guy once say, I got to apologize to you. I'm like, what for? He goes, I saw you earlier at the conference, and I thought, who is this hot dog? You know? And he goes, I wrote you off. And he goes, and when you spoke, God just broke my heart. I was like, wow, I was so wrong. I said, you don't have to apologize. I said, we all do that. It's human nature. We look at people, we size them up, and we figured them out, and we know nothing. Because when do we have the ability to see inside the human heart like God does? Like, never. We have to at least give people a chance to see who they are. So based on all this negativity I've felt, you know, 30 years of doing ministry, I remember I was visiting the evangelist Luis Palau. If you guys know Luis Palau, he was a beautiful man. He just recently passed. And I remember being up at his office in Portland, Oregon. And he just gave me three words. He just said, don't give up. Don't give up. Because sometimes you want to give up because people keep hurting you and people keep wronging you. People keep not giving you a chance. And you just want to go, well, forget you guys, you know. But he said, don't give up. And it was just three simple words. I'm now on staff at a church in Roseville, California, called Bayside. They're kind of a church, a mega church or whatever. And I remember just before they asked me to join the church and be on staff, I shared this story with some of you guys the other night. But there was a friend of mine, a Christian worship songwriter, wrote a lot of famous songs, and he was pitching me to a church pastor that he knew in the Northern California area. And the church pastor sent him back an email and said, hey, I ran that idea of having your Zoro friend come to our church, but all of our 9 elders unanimously agreed they didn't want him. They said, we don't want your friend Zoro. And they said, yeah, there's still the jokes going on around about his hat and his clothes, and they were like, another elder said, we can't have a guy come to our church with the name Zorro. So they, and this email was so, I was so like furious. I was so broken. And I was like, they never even looked at me on the internet to see who I am, to see what I speak like. They just immediately casted the judgment. And I was so hurt by this. And it was, of the 9 elders, not one of them. And I wanted to write them an email to tell them what I really thought. And I did write the email, I just never sent it. But it was very therapeutic writing it, because I want to say, I said, 0 out of 9 of you qualify for the qualifications of an elder according to the Bible, because all of you guys are Pharisees who just judge harshly and condemn. That's the righteous indignation part coming out, the fire of my Latin Irish heritage coming out. But I never wrote it, but I lifted it up to God. And I just, and so, and then 6 months later is when they asked me to come on staff at this church, Bayside. And the pastor there, who I'd known for about 15 years, the first night that I came and it was official that I was on staff, he gave me two words. He said, welcome home. So that felt incredible after the rejection of that other letter and just the years of being rejected by the church itself, you know, when all I'm trying to do is, and what the other thing I wanted to write in that letter, which I did, I said, while you guys are busy condemning me and you haven't spent 1 second me, meanwhile, while you're doing that, I'm leading hundreds and thousands of people to the Lord all throughout my life. But you're so busy judging and condemning me. And the reason why there aren't a lot of Christians in the world is because of people like you, who all you do is condemn people. They never feel the love of God from you. They feel the judgment and the wrath of God from you, even though you're not God. They never feel your love. I know this. I'm a broken sinner like everybody else, but people will always feel my love wherever I go. Before they know who I am, before anything, they will feel my love. And when they feel that, they will be way more receptive to hearing about my Jesus. But they're not going to want to know your Jesus when all they feel is your judgment. And it's the simplest thing in the world, but I don't understand why so many people don't get that in the church. Our job is to love people. It's God's job to judge them. My job is just to love them. It's the grace of God that I'm saved, so I'm going to give that grace to other people. So then, bringing the message to a close here, then there's this man, Rick Joyner, and he has no idea because Rick is just Rick. He's just a wonderfully beautiful, kind soul, just as deep as he is kind. And we met many years ago in Nashville. A mutual friend of ours introduced us, and from then we just sort of clicked, and then he invited me to one of the Morningstar conferences. But he was not cut out of the cloth that I was used to, which are all the people that write you off before they see what you have to offer. He just invited me warmly. And the other night, he's always been an encouragement. When I wrote my book, Soar, 3 years before it was out, I sent him the manuscript by a Word document. And he said, I absolutely love your book. And I was like, wow, this heavy hitter of the spirit, this father of the of so many tribes he's built, he likes my book. I can't believe it. But he would keep calling me and he would say, let me know how I can help. And I didn't even really know what that meant because, when somebody says that, what do they mean? And so I never really asked him. And then he would call me again and say, man, I love that book. Let me know how I can help. And he said it about 3 or 4 times over a few years. And then he's the one who encouraged me, and is through his encouragement and offering to help is the reason I put the book out. And then the reason why, and then he invited me, he said, well, have you come to the Harvest Conference. This was, around 2016. Let's have you come to the Harvest Conference and I'll have you speak and we can launch the book. I mean, I've never met anybody who does that. You know what I mean? Who saw value in me. And the other night, this is just true, This isn't like lip service. I'm just speaking the truth. And then the other night, or the other day, the other morning when I spoke here, he said something and I wrote it down and I will take that with me to the grave. But he said, he goes, after I was done speaking, he goes, Zoro, isn't he a treasure? And I was like, wow. To be thought of as a treasure. Don't we all want to be somebody's treasure? Don't we all want to be God's treasure? You know what I mean? But no one's ever said that about me. They've said what those other 9 elders said. We don't like his hat. We don't like his name. We don't like his clothes. We don't want him. And then here's a man who goes, isn't he a treasure? And I'm not saying it like that I think I'm so special or anything, but the fact that somebody would say that about me or feel that way about me, those are words, when we die, the thing that we're going to remember most are the people who touched us and said nice things to us. We're not going to remember money, fame. We're not going to remember anything except, oh, I remember he said that about me once. We're going to remember the words that people spoke to us. And those, to me, I collect all the words. I save all the cards people have written me, the thank you cards from churches or conferences or the thousands of students that I've taught over the years that I've influenced and inspired and try to be a father to. And they'll send me a card saying, I've given so many drum lessons in my life. When I used to live in LA, I bought like 5,000 copies of a book called Armageddon Oil and the Middle East Crisis. It was a book about the end times. And the reason why I bought that many copies, well, they were on sale at CBD. They were, that book, Christian book distributor place. I was like, they're $1 each. I'm buying 5,000 of them. I literally gave them out one by one. But I remember I would give them out to every student I gave a lesson to because it would scare the hell out of you, the book, because it was about the end of the age. And I thought, this is great. This is going to terrify them into Jesus. I'm going to scare the hell out of these students. And then at the end, it had a prayer of salvation. I thought, perfect. Perfect. Scare the crap out of them. And then you got a way out of this thing. Jesus. And so I gave all those out. Then I bought thousands of copies of More Than a Carpenter, The Purpose-Driven Life. And every time I'd have a student that would study with me for an hour, then I would spend another hour or two with them ministering to them. And I would buy all these and hand them a whole bouquet of books going out. And then 5 or 6 years later, or 10 years later, I'd run into a kid at the airport and go, "Hey, Zoro." And I don't know who it is because I don't remember because I've had thousands of. He goes, "Do you remember me?" I go, "No, I know, but tell me about it." Go, "Oh, I came over your house a few days in a row and my wife and I were having trouble years ago and you and your wife mentored us," and I don't even remember the whole thing happening. And our life got together. Or I'll meet another guy and say, "You know, I took one lesson from you once in 1995 and you probably don't remember, but you gave me a stack of books and Bibles. I want you to know, I'm a pastor now because of that encounter that I had with you." Just crazy stories like that. So the most recent one is I was on a plane many years ago, maybe 15, 20 years ago. I was on a plane sitting next to a guy. I was mad about the seat I got moved to. I had an aisle seat. It was a long flight to Germany or whatever. And I'm like, "Oh, great, I got my aisle." And then they say, "Oh, sorry, we have to move you over here." And so now I'm crammed in between this other guy. And so the guy next to me, I just wanted to go to sleep. And I felt the Lord say, "Talk to him about my son." And I was like, "Really?" "Yeah, talk to him about my son." I was like, "Okay." Because I usually do what God asks. And so he was from Denmark, and he really never heard the story of Jesus. He didn't really know much about the Bible or about God or about anything. But I ended up ministering to him for like 5 or 6 hours. And then I had a prophetic word for him, and I prayed over him and recorded on my phone. And I said, "Give me your address, and when I get back home, I'll send you some books." So when I got back home, I had a beautiful leather-bound Bible that Lenny Kravitz bought for me to give out to people. And on it was engraved, "Let Love Rule," which was the name of his first album. And so I sent him a Bible. I sent him a stack of books. Probably cost like $250 for the books and the Bible and to send it and to go down to the post office and fill out the stupid form. But that's just how I rolled. Because I go, there's a chance for me to maybe change this man's life. And he's going to think I'm never going to remember him because he met me on a plane. And then when he got the package of books, he was blown away that I remembered him because I sent it several months later. So this is just like 6 months ago. So I get a text on my phone and it says, "Frederick Hilding," or whatever. And I'm like, who is that? I got to have the number because it's in my phone. The name is showing up. And I go look in the phone, it says, "Guy you sat on the plane with on the way to Germany in 1995 or whatever. Because I had his number so I could text him the prophetic word I had. And he texted me and he goes, "Zoro," he goes, I want to know if you're still following Jesus because I am now following Jesus with the whole of my heart and I met my bride and we're following Jesus and it's all because of you." And it really touched me. And I was like, "Oh my God, that's the guy that I was on the plane with." And I said, "Give me your address now and I'll send you a copy of my book, Soar, and all my stuff." And I don't know, I'm just sharing these things with you because it's all through the power of words. I spoke to that man. Sometimes you'll have a 30-second encounter with people. Sometimes you'll have a 5-minute encounter. Sometimes it'll be 5 hours. Sometimes it'll be 5 years. You don't know what you have, but you have a chance to alter the destiny of other people based on the simple words you speak. God's not going to hold me accountable to speak to the guy at the airport for 5 hours when I got to catch a flight in 30 seconds. But if I meet somebody for a minute, I'm going to be as kind as I can for that minute. And I'm going to say as many positive things as I can. And every time somebody recognizes me in the airport, it's a musician or a drummer, and sometimes it's a kid, sometimes it's an older man, and I'll usually hand them a pair of sticks or an autograph card or whatever. But I'll always say something to them. I always say, "Well, you're going to do something amazing. I'm so glad that I met you." You know, just something to like fuel them up. It costs me nothing, but it's so joyful. But I'm telling you, year after year, there's people that I meet that I've had these encounters with that I've long forgotten about because I'm not calculating, I'm not keeping track, I'm not even telling you the stories for you to go how wonderful I am. That is not my motive. My motive is to tell you so you can do it too. Because if I can do it, and I'm nobody, I'm just a simple man with a childlike faith, if I can go around doing it all over the world with the little thing that God gave me, then you can do it too. And it's like what Rick and it's like what Chris said, if you can, if we just disciple one person. Now, I know I've met thousands and have sent out thousands of books and Bibles and everywhere I go, but we can at least do one. We can at least do one. Don't worry about what people think when you share the Lord with them, because the only thing you should be worried about is what God thinks. None of those people are going to be there when on Judgment Day. None of the people that you were afraid, oh my gosh, what if they see me in the post office talking about Jesus or praying for a person? I'm going to look so weird, you know? You know what looks weirder is the guy who's going postal, not you. You know what I mean? You're just sharing the love of God. You know, don't be worried about the opinions of other people. They're not going to be there to judge you. The only opinions you ever care about is Him. And just concern yourself with pleasing Him. Well, I went over, and this is the first time I've done that in my history of my ministry. I went longer than I was supposed to. I got carried away into the story. But that's my story, and that's all I need to say. And I thank you guys for listening and enduring. And I speak a blessing over all of you. Father God, every soul here, every person here, Lord, I decree Your love for them. Lord, I decree unlimitless potential. I pray for supernatural dreams and ideas to resurface. I pray for retooling, resetting, recalibrating their lives. There's people here that are broken. There's people here that feel discouraged, Lord. I just release supernatural miracles by the way of words. I speak healing, whatever their need is, physical, spiritual, financial, relational, emotional. I pray that those needs would be met. But I pray more than anything, Lord, a fire inside each person here would arise, the fire to become everything You created them to be, to walk in that destiny, that identity, that and to have the courage to be a son or a daughter of God, and to be a living epistle of light and love everywhere they go, and that they would speak words of life. Thank You so much, Lord, for bringing me to the Morningstar camp and into the life and heart of Rick Joyner and Chris Reed and everybody else in this place I've met in the last 15 years. Thank You, thank You, thank You. In Jesus' name, amen.